Jesus' name we have prayed.
Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Thank the Lord for the Bible study tonight. We're doing this so that on Monday, after finishing the retreat tomorrow, we don't have to go for Bible study in the night, so we'll become free Monday night in Jesus' name. We're going to rise up, we're going to pray. You want to commit yourself to the Lord in prayer, that the Bible study will reach to your soul tonight, that God will give you the heart of a real obedient child of God, that your mind, your heart, your willingness, readiness, be focused on the word of God. Open your mouth and pray and tell the Lord, oh Lord, we are here to serve you, here to listen to your word, here to love you, love your word, give you the honor, the glory, adoration, respect that is due to your name, and all childishness, frivolity, carelessness, carefree attitude, adults behaving like babies, people of God behaving like people of the world, that God will take that away from your heart, your life. That as obedient children will be obedient to the word of God. You have a heart that wants to love the Lord and serve the Lord, that wants to help others, to focus, concentrate on the word of God without serving as a stumbling block or distraction to those who have come to worship the Lord with us. Pray the spirit of disobedience will not take over your life in little things and great things, major, minor things. In Jesus' name we pray. Heavenly Father, we bless your name for bringing us together as obedient children, respectful children, faithful children, converted people who have put away worldly, sinful things in our lives. We're praying, Lord, as we come to the Bible study tonight, you reach out to every soul and everyone in Jesus' name. We'll pray that you give us understanding in your word, that we'll be like these people that we're reading about. Our lives will bring glory unto you all through the days of our lives. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. We've been studying about the church of the Thessalonians. And we remember that these Thessalonian believers became born again, converted, as Paul, Silas, and Timothy went to them. Read about that in Acts of the Apostles chapter 17. Acts chapter 17, verse 1. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. That already tells us the people that were in that congregation, eventually when the gospel came to them and they were converted, we have different classes and diverse classes of people there. and the surprising thing, and the exciting thing, and the beautiful thing is that they maintain a wonderful, excellent unity. There were Jews attending that synagogue. These were people that had the word of God. When they had the word of God, all they were committed to before, the circumcision and the tradition of the elders, all that passed away. They were born again. They were converted. They were transformed. Their lives were turned around. A mighty transformation are taking place. In that church, we had people referred to as devout Greeks. Look at verse 2. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, 3 Sabbath days reasoning with them out of the scriptures, and opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. And some of them believed and consulted, they agreed, associated, they got affiliated, they joined with Paul and Silas. And of the devout Greeks, a great multitude. The devout Greeks were there that became converted. Those Greeks, before their conversion, they took pride in knowledge. They took pride in worldly wisdom. But as they became converted, a mighty change came upon them as well. Look at the characteristics of those Greeks in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, for the Greeks seek after wisdom. That was their nature. That was their concentration. That was their peculiarity. That was their idol. That was their commitment. That was what they were addicted to. But now they got converted, and there was a mighty transformation. Come back to Acts chapter 17, verse 4. And some of them believed and consulted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks, a great multitude, and of the chief women, not a few. There were also some chief women, honorable women, that became converted in Thessalonica. These were women, elevated women of high rank and standing in the community. They were women of influence, and they also had connection with distinguished people in the land, in society. And we're told, when these honorable women, these chief women, these exalted women, these women of high rank and standing in society, when they became converted, a mighty change also came upon them. Look at verse 12 of that Acts chapter 17. Therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women, which were Greeks and of men, not a few. We see have another class of people that became converted in the Thessalonian church. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. But they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we had unto you, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. There were idol worshippers there too. And these idol worshippers, they heard the word of God. When they had the word of God, that word of God had a transforming effect, a converting effect in their lives. When anyone actually hears the word of the Lord, and he hears it savingly, and he hears it in such an effective, effectual manner, that word of God does what he taught to do in Psalm 19. Psalm 19, I'm reading from verse 7. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The law of the Lord, the word of the Lord, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, perfect, penetrating, pungent, touching our lives. It says, it is so perfect, it converts the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. A kind of conversion that those Thessalonians had was practical, was visible, was noticeable for the people to see. Let's look at Acts of the Apostles again. Acts of the Apostles, reading from chapter 15. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15, verse 3. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles, and it caused great joy unto all the brethren, declaring the conversion, the transformation, the turning around, the change in the lives of those people. I said their conversion was visible. I said it was practical. I said it was noticeable. How visible was the conversion? How noticeable was the conversion? And how practical was the conversion? Acts chapter 19, reading from verse 18. The conversion of those Gentiles, the conversion of those devout Greeks, the conversion of those notable, honorable chief women, the conversion of those Jews who had earlier been committed to the tradition of the elders was so visible and practical and noticeable. Acts chapter 19, verse 18. And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. They believed and they confessed and they made visible, noticeable their past deeds. Verse 19, many of them also, which used curious arts, brought their books together, and they bunched them before all men, and they counted the price of them, and found it 50 pieces of silver. And you see today, if anybody gets converted today, anybody gets born again today, the life becomes different. The conduct becomes different. The character becomes different. Noticeable, visible, practical. A real change comes upon such an individual. In fact, we are told about another group of people in a neighboring town that also became born again just after the Thessalonians were born again. And we're even told they went beyond the Thessalonian believers. Acts of the Apostles chapter 17. I'm reading from verse 10. Acts chapter 17 verse 10. And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica. I pray our church will be like that. We're saying that these Thessalonian believers, they were wonderful, wonderful converts, saved converts. And the converts that had a kind of shining life, beaming out and shining forth the gospel and the obedience and the faithfulness and the transformation were very clear in their lives. But now we're even told about another group of believers, the Bereans. It says they were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind. Their mind was on the word. Their heart was on the word. Their attention was on the word. Their concentration was on the word. They received the word with all readiness of mind. And then it says, they searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. And among these, they are not just ordinary people. We're told in verse 12, therefore, many of them believed, also of the honorable women, which were Greeks and of men, not a few. I pray that that same grace be noticeable in every life in Jesus' name. That church of the Thessalonians became committed to the gospel, going everywhere. We're looking at the witness of transformed believers. The witness of transformed believers. And we're dividing the study to three parts. Number one, the exceptional soul winning by saved Christians. Christians who are born again. Christians who have definite experience of knowing the Lord. Christians that have the experience that something has taken place affecting their soul, their spirit, their mind, their lifestyle, their character, their conduct, their day-to-day lifestyle living. Exceptional soul winning by those saved Christians. Number two, exemplary separation from a sinful community. Their community was sinful, and yet there was an exemplary separation. They separated themselves from the idolatry of the land, from the evil of the land, from the pollution of the land, from the careless life, defiling life of the land. Exemplary separation from a sinful community. Number three, expectant saints waiting for Christ's second coming. Expectant saints waiting for Christ's second coming. Number one, exceptional soul winning by saved Christians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, we're reading from verse 8. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 8. For you, Thessalonians, sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God's word is spread abroad, so that we need not to speak anything. These Thessalonian believers, what a wonderful assembly. What a wonderful congregation. The young and the old, the men and the women, the high and the lowly, the honorable and the humble, how they gave themselves to the Lord. And it says all of them without exception, they had such a touch of the Lord in their lives. and such transformation in their lives that the word of God sounded out from them. One in Macedonia, not only that. Two in Achaia, not only that. Three in every place, their faith to God's word was spread abroad, so that when the apostles go to those other places, they didn't have to say anything. The gospel was being preached already by life and by their mouth, by those Thessalonian believers. Look at the way the world worked in them. This is the way it will work in us. I say it will work in us. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. For this cause also, thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men. There's a secret of having the word work in their hearts. They came with the gospel of God, the gospel of Christ, the gospel of grace, the gospel of peace, the gospel of your salvation, the gospel of the kingdom, and the gospel that is everlasting, the everlasting gospel. And the people realized this is not the word of man, and they acted as if God came down in human flesh to talk to them. And because of that attitude of mind and disposition, it says, ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us. Ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. They believed that word. Then they became proclaimers of that gospel. And with enthusiasm, with passion, with fire, with fervency, with desire, with purpose of mind, they declared it in Macedonia, in Achaia, as well as in every place. The city of Thessalonica was strategically located in the province of Macedonia. It was a hub of travel and trade, and people were coming through Macedonia, from Macedonia, from the east and the west, and they'll go along the Egnatian highway. They always pass through Thessalonica, and when those travelers and traders were passing through, the Thessalonians will engage them in the communication of the gospel, in the preaching of the gospel, and then you give them the gospel. Their conversation was of the gospel. Their communication was of the gospel. Their sharing was of the gospel. Their interaction was of the gospel. That is the way it ought to be today. That in the market, on the bus, in the taxi, at school, anywhere you go, in your free time, in your busy time, you are sharing the gospel. You're speaking the gospel. You are spreading the gospel. Not only that, there were multitudes of people who also visited the city by sea, because it was a city that had ports. And there were people that wanted to use the port facilities in Thessalonica. And the people of God in Thessalonica, the servants of God, and the Christians, the believers, they went to the port. And what were they sharing? They were sharing the gospel. We will share the gospel. Everywhere we go, we look at all the places and all the strategic locations in the city.